Did anyone ever contact you?
No, starting with Skelter, they wanted to know, they asked me if I wanted to meet Manson, and I didn't, because I didn't want him to manipulate me, make me think that he was something that he wasn't, because I didn't want him to have any, so I watched, there was a documentary that was done on him in 69, and I watched it probably 10 times, just to see how he moved. You know, I spoke, for all different kinds of reasons.
I love that scene in the courtroom, the blonde scene where you're giving the speech.
I'm giving the speech, yes. I was just going to get to that. See, I don't act a negative, I act a positive. I wouldn't know how to play a killer. So I got to make a positive out of it.
Yeah.
You know, and... people talk about that speech a lot, and I'm very proud of that speech.
Yeah,
by the way, it was done in one take with three cameras. It probably would never have happened again. It just happened.
I never went to school, so I never learned how to read or write too good. And I stayed in jail, and I stayed stupid. And I stayed a child while I watched your world grow up. And then I look at what you do, and I don't understand. You eat meat, and you kill things that are better than you are. And then you say how bad, or even killers, your children are. These children that come at you with knives, they're your children. You taught them. I didn't teach them. I just tried to help them stand up. The people you call my family were people you didn't want. People alongside the road that their parents had kicked out. So I took them to my garbage dump and I fed them. And I taught them that in love there's no wrong. I can't dislike you. But I can say this to you. It's not going to be long before you all kill yourselves because you're all crazy. And you can project it back on me. But I'm only what lives in each and every one of you. My father's a jailhouse. My father's your system. I'm a reflection of you. I'm what you made me. I've ate out of your garbage cans to stay out of jail. I've worn your secondhand clothes. I've tried my best to get along in your world. And now you say you want to kill me. And I look at you and I say to myself, you want to kill me. I'm already dead. I have been all my life. I spent 23 years in tombs that you built. Sometimes I want to give it all back to you. Sometimes I just want to jump on you and let you shoot me. If I could, I'd grab this microphone and I'd beat your brains out with it because that's what you deserve. That's what you deserve. These children, everything they've done for the love of brother. Is that a conspiracy? Is it a conspiracy that the music is telling the youth to rise up against the establishment because the establishment is rapidly destroying things? Is that a conspiracy? The music speaks to you every day, but you're too deaf, dumb, and blind to listen. It's not my conspiracy. It's not my music. I hear what it relates. It's this rise, it's this kill. Why blame it on me? I didn't write the music. How can you blame what you do on your children? And what about your children, huh? What about them? You say they're just a few? Well, there are many, many more. And they're running in the streets. They're all running in the same direction. And they're running right at you. You don't have to testify.
I remember I sat down and people were talking and I asked everybody if they could please sit down because I had something I had to say. And now what you saw was I don't mind saying this. I've said it before. There was a time in my life where I never gave away choices. Choices. My through line, okay. There's a through line, which was, there were two people in New York that were trying to take me down. This is a fact. So before I came out to do Skelter, so right there I had my through line, because all I could do is sit back and say, okay, you got me. And then in that through line, I make choices. And when I gave that speech in Skelter, I was UC Manson. But what I was talking about, I was talking about actors. I was not talking about, I can only come from a positive. And I was talking about how you have no right to take somebody's gift away. You have no right to try to take their confidence away. You have no right. And if I could, I'd take this microphone and I'd beat your brains out with it, because that's what you deserve.
I love that.
But that's a choice. When I finished that speech, it ended when I stood up. And I felt like 1,000 pounds had been lifted off my shoulders, because I got it all out.
Nowadays they'd ask for safety. Can we go again?
No, there was no safety. I remember.
Yeah. Memorize the whole scene.
I don't remember. The words kind of lent itself in some ways, but I the words kind of come. It's where do those words come from? That's the most important. We have the three of us, we're very fortunate people, because and Ed Gein, real quick, because I don't want to be the only one speaking up here. Ed Gein was something I really loved doing, because I had 3 months to prep him. I had 3 months, and I love prep. I love that. And the tiny things that you find, the nuggets that you find, I remember. I have a book called DSM-3 and a book called DSM-4, and what's the psychiatrist use, and at UCLA, and in residency, and I was, they always, in all the books that were about Ed Gein, they referred to the sly smile. And that's because they had no diagnosis for it at the time. And I had to find out, was he hiding something? What was this? And I was looking through a certain kind of schizophrenia one night about midnight, and it was, they had the, all about the schizophrenia, and then they had the characteristics. And I remember it was number 3, 1, 2, 3, and it said, a sly smile. And I hit gold. I woke up the entire house screaming, because he was not, he didn't even know he was doing it. It was part of his illness. And I discovered that night. And those little things, those little nuggets, are just...
When he lost his mind, he was telling us psychosis.
He was schizophrenic, yeah. But the thing was, is that he didn't, about the smile, he wasn't consciously doing it, which meant everything to me.
Yeah.
But anyway.
Anybody else?
I got nothing to say after that. I know that he would make a great detective because he's very thorough, not just a great actor.
Well, that's, you know, honestly, that's what actors do. And when you play real people, when you play someone that really existed, you have all of these amazing things to go in and research. But even if a character you play is a fictional person, you almost always have to base it on something. You have to make it something real. If you want it to come from a real place, it's so easy just to come out and play. Like, I see movies all the time, and a guy is quote-unquote a bad guy, and he just plays being bad guy. And that's the most boring thing you could ever do, because no person thinks of themselves that way. You know, the greatest, you know, hero and the greatest bad guy that ever lived, they all think they're the good guy. They all think that what they're doing is important, and they believe in what they are in themselves. And you have to be able to find that in the work and put that on the screen in order to make something really live and breathe. And, you know, what we do is a very strange thing. It's this never-ending search for truth, to try to find some piece of truth and honesty that you can put up on the screen. And every character is about finding that truth. And sometimes you have months to prepare, like Steven just said, he had 3 months. I love that myself. Then sometimes you get the phone call, how do you feel about going to Bulgaria in 10 minutes? You know, it's a,
get those,
but you have to find the truth anyway, you know, and that's really what it's all about. And we are, like Steve was saying, you know, we're very fortunate people because, you know, we get to do, first of all, we all have passion about what we do. We love what we do. And just the fact that somewhere along the lines we were graced with the ability to do it, and then somebody gave us a chance and an opportunity to do it, it's really, you know, it's what it's all about, you know. And to keep the passion alive, no matter what your age, and to kind of stay like a child, a little in your heart, is really, you know, where it's at. Don't believe the headlines. Don't believe the good reviews or the bad reviews.
Don't believe your own PR.
You
know,
just
me.
Do the work. Find the truth every time. Workaholic.
Well, can you talk about Once Upon a Time in America?
Sure. Oh, God, yeah. Well, you know, that, you know, first of all, I could tell you the audition process that I went through. I got a call, had an agent, and he wasn't a big agent. I mean, he had been around, but he wasn't like one of the big, you know, agencies. And I got a rush phone call, and it was like, you need to get to the Chateau Marmont right now. I got you an interview for this gangster picture. This is all he said to me. So I had no idea what I was getting into. Hmm. So I went down, and I walked in, and Joy Todd was there, and I'm like, and she's like, she looks at me, and she's studying me, and she looks, and she goes, good face. She goes, go home, prepare a monologue, come back tomorrow. About a minute and a half. I still had no idea what movie this was that I was in going home. I went home, wrote a monologue, and of all things, I based the character in the monologue, I based a little bit on my grandfather, and my grandfather, who had just passed away. And when my grandfather got mad,
he did this thing, and if you saw it coming, you better get the hell out of there. He just had this look, and suddenly his eye would go. He'd cock one eye just for a second, and then he'd come at you. And whenever I saw that eye, I'd move. So I used that choice of all things in my monologue. I do the monologue, I feel good about it. I go, and then as I'm leaving the room, somebody goes, isn't it amazing to be auditioning for a Sergio Leone, Robert De Niro movie? And I'm like, what? What? I go home, I got a phone, I have a message already. And it was from Joy, and it was, Sergio saw your tape, he wants you to come back immediately. So I was like, oh my God. I mean, I went back and I walked in the room and he's sitting there in this robe, looking like Zeus, and, you know, just magnificent. He's looking at me, you know, like this, and studying me, and he says to me, you know, you're very good, and then he says to me, of all things, I just made this choice arbitrarily to use my grandfather's tick without knowing, and he says to me, he said, there's a part in my movie, his name is Cockeye. He goes, he said, when I, of all the things to say to someone, he said, when I saw this character, he said, I always saw your face, he said to me. And then he said,
like
you, oh yeah. And he goes, when you did the monologue, he goes, you did a thing with your eye. And of all things, it was my grandfather.
Unbelievable.
You know, and you know, who had just passed away. And he said, and he, you know, and then he told me, he said, the part's 90% yours. Yeah, the other 10 took another 4 months, but you know, yeah. A special experience. He had the greatest eye of any director I've ever worked with. His love of the cinema, his humanity. You know, my nickname for him was Santa Claus with the shiv. I mean, he was beautiful and nice, but he was tough. I mean, I saw him do things that just would blow your mind. I mean, I never forget when Tuesday Weld had this very important moment in the movie, a very emotional moment. And Sergio's Tuesday, he's just, you know, and he's so sweet and loving to Tuesday Weld, and it's Tuesday, and I'm watching him, and suddenly it's Madore, and the camera starts to roll, and he just as quietly as can be, stroking her and just being beautiful to her, and then suddenly right in her face, he goes, action! And she goes, boom, and there was the scene. It was amazing to watch. I mean, I could go on all day. He was.
I don't know about you guys, but I'm really enjoying this session. I'm glad I was invited. There's a Russian word called sudba. Sudba is fate, destiny. Talk about destiny. He was meant to play that part. That eye story is fantastic.
Fate.
Yeah. And my grandfather just said to me before he passed away, he goes, hey, you know. He goes, how come everybody out in Hollywood, they're all getting divorced? I said, I don't know.
Never thought of it.
Then he found out. Yeah. He went there.
Yeah, the hard way.
I can't top these stories, but these guys remind me of other guys that I've actually worked with. They're pretty much legendary. I don't want to get too precious, but they're real actors, right? And now we have actors that are good, and some are great, and some are not, and people are on shows, but it keeps me hungry, because these stories are a little part of history, you know, that we don't always hear. You got to go read a book, which is great too, but it's special to have these little stories, I think.
Well, you got a few yourself.
Yeah, I was just going to say that. Yeah.
Well, one of my favorite moments, I'm going to drop some names, right? So my first big movie was called Mobsters, and the great Anthony Quinn was in that film. Everybody know Anthony Quinn, right? I'll never forget, it was the first big film, and I didn't want to be late, so I ran to the trailers. I was just on time. But, you know, I was nervous, first big Hollywood movie. And the trailers were lined up like this. The doors are open. When the doors are open, you can't see your name. So one door, no, that's not me. I finally get to the last trailer. I'm like, it's gotta be mine. I jump in, dump my bag. And all of a sudden I hear, who are you? It was Anthony Quinn's trailer. Right? I turn around and I see him. Now I'm a Greek and he did this thing called Zorba the Greek. So I turned around, I panicked. I went red and I went, Mr. Quinn, I'm sorry, I'm in the wrong trailer. He goes, come here, talk to me. He stood up, and he was like, he was 9 foot tall, you know what I mean? Like a legend, right? I didn't know what to do because I had to run to the thing, so I just hugged him out of fear. He started laughing. Really, right? And I ran to the makeup, we get ready, and I see him on the set with his garb on. He had a fat suit on because he played a guy that was bigger. And my first scene with Anthony Quinn that day was me shooting him. I love telling that story because after that we became friends and he used to invite me out and, you know, like, where are you? Come now. And I'd run, you know what I mean? So that's a good little story.
Greatest.
He was a wonderful actor.
Yeah.
They worked together.
Yeah. He was special. I actually had I've told you this story, but I had in 82 when I was doing Once Upon a Time in America, we were doing, if you recall, there was the scene where we were in the bordello. And basically they hired probably 500 of the most exquisite women that were in Europe to play all these girls in the bordello. So that day on the set, any male in the city somehow found a reason to show up on the set. Any red-blooded male, and it was hysterical. Suddenly out of nowhere, in comes Anthony Quinn, comes walking in, you know. It was phenomenal. And everybody made their way to the set that day. And it was a really great day. I remember one of the things, I mean, I loved Anthony. I had read his original biography called The Original Sin, which is this tremendous, like, strange autobiography. So I was a big fan of Anthony's. Anthony Quinn, myself, and Robert De Niro, we walked all over Chinatown for 4 hours together. And Anthony Quinn did all the talking, and Robert and I just listened. And it was just phenomenal, you know, and just listen to all these stories and all these amazing things that he had experienced. And, you know, that's, again, another piece of the luck of what we do, is to be able to be touched by these great people, these legends, these, you know, and then, you know, let a little piece of that run through you, you know. It's really a blessing.
Did you feel, intimidated?
I was probably too stupid to feel intimidated. I don't know. I loved him. You got to understand, my story with Robert De Niro, I walked into a theater and I saw Mean Streets. I didn't know Robert De Niro. I didn't know Martin Scorsese. I didn't know anything about any of those guys at that moment. When I walked out of that theater, I went, oh my God, what did I just see? That was the work. That was something going through me at that moment that excited me and made me want to be an actor. I was so turned on by seeing that film that I walked back into the movie theater and I applied for a job as an usher. I got the job and I worked the entire run of Mean Streets, and the minute the movie left the theater, I quit. But I saw it a lot.
I have a question. You talked about the Manson, playing the Manson role.
Mm-hmm.
Or any of the roles that you guys have played, I've heard and read about sometimes they're very difficult in turning it off at the end of the day. Is that something you've ever experienced? Any of you? Turning the role off when the day's over?
No, I'll be honest with you. I'll give an example of when I did Ed Gein. Somebody noticed this, Bill Cross, and he played my father in that, Ed's father in that, and he was a dear friend of mine. And I'd be in the trailer, and Carrie would come in, Carrie Snodgrass, who would, I love so much. She was just, we lost her, and what a great, incredible person she was, an actress. But anyway, she'd come into my trailer and we'd start talking. And they're ready, Steve. And anyway, I would walk out of the trailer. And when this was brought up to me, I realized what I was doing. I'd walk out of the trailer and I'd start walking down to the farmhouse. And about halfway to the farmhouse, I'd become Ed. This is the way it was pointed out to me. And this Bill would notice a transition, and I'd walk, and I'd walk in the tryhouse, and I'd be Ed. But it's all the work that I did, and you know, it's not. Anyway, I'd go in, and as I would do this, and it wasn't like I was. I knew what I was doing, but the, and as I walked back, as Bill would put it, he'd see me, he'd see Ed leave and Steve come back, and I'd go back in the trailer and I'd just be me. But no, I can't remember ever not being able to walk away. You know, when I was doing Ed, I came home to my kids. What am I going to do? Eat them? No, love them. So.
But you got your tricks, you know. I mean, of course. You know, there are ways you have to. I mean, I had a horrible experience. I played Gacy, and you know, and it was, I got, and I do it always crazy and correctly, and I went and I started to do my research on him. And it pissed me off because I realized that his whole life was a lie. That when I got there, suddenly recent history was being covered up. And that really pissed me off, so I stayed an extra few weeks and I Hardy Boyed the hell out of Gacy. In fact, I got to the point where I started to discover all these things the cops didn't even know as I was unfolding him. And it's weird because as you start getting closer to a monster, you know, you want to know what makes them tick. You want to know the human side of all these things, but you can't help but to have, in some way, to be affected by the behavior of a monster. And so you have to have your tricks. You have to have your guardian angels. You have to have your ways of slipping out of it. You know, Steve was just talking about the walk where he walked into the character and he walked out of it. But you need to have all these crazy, I mean, of all the things, I'll tell you one thing I had for some reason. The whole time I made and played him, I kept having visions of James Dean. And for some reason, James Dean ended up being like, call it a guardian angel for me. And so I wore, every time I was dressed up as Gacy in that movie, I always had a James Dean tie on, and that it was always basically taped right here to my heart. And I, the whole time I played him, and you know what? It was literally that to me. It was like a, you know, and because there were, for some reason, you know, the hatred that I had, I began to have hatred for him. That, and you can't act, you can't judge. That's not what we do. So you have to discover the opposite of that, but you have to live with it. But I can tell you this, the moment it was over, I just put on the Beach Boys and I ran down to the Caribbean and I spent like 4 or 5 months just totally getting as far away, you know, from him as I could, because I didn't ever want to think of him again, you know.
I didn't know you played him.
It came out in whatever, 2011, I think. It's called Dear Mr. Gacy.
Dear Mr. Gacy.
It's great, but it's a very disturbing movie. I'll never watch it again. I'll never watch it again. I mean, I'm very proud of it, and I exposed the son of a bitch. But it's a very disturbing movie. It takes a little piece of you, and you never get it back.
More disturbing than the other one?
Well, by far. Yeah.
I believe we're all going to get that video. I'm going to watch it. I didn't know. You don't have to see it again. I'll do it for you.
Get it. Tell me what you think.
What have you done to me?
Can I ask you a follow-up on that?
Sure.
That line of questioning? If it was that traumatic now that you won't watch it again, how did you process it while you were doing it?
I go at it, I break it down. I'm a detective. I went and met everyone. I mean, I can tell you right now, I met everyone who knew, like, I got in close. I met his childhood friends. I got as close as I could to this guy because I wanted to, once I agreed to play him, I wanted to expose him. You know, this was a person that even the truth that we have, you watch the biographies on him, a lot of it is lies. Mm. And I discovered who this bastard was, and I brought him to life, you know. But it's like, I don't want to be there again. It's really hard. I mean, his childhood friend was a guy named Barry Boscelli. He's a beautiful man, but he's a victim of John, you know, his life is, he's John's last victim, truly. And it's very, you know, you can't let that kind of thing affect you. Like, I owned something that belonged to him that I used in the movie. I had a name patch that was John, and it was his actual name patch. I had it put on my wardrobe. I don't let it live in my house. It lives outside. I mean, I won't even let it in my house because, you know,
but people, at the same time, you can't judge a character.
No, but I don't want that damn thing living in my house.
No, I understand that. I understand that.
Yeah, you know. But you know, it can be, you know, but you can't allow those things to take over you. You know, you just can't in any way. I mean, that's part of being a professional. But you want to get as close as you can to the fire. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But you know it's there, and you got to be careful.
Yeah, absolutely.
I suggest nobody F's with my two friends. They've gone to a scary place.
Stories about Saw?
That was a good one. Yeah, you know what? I walked into a franchise that was already sailing beautifully, so I didn't want to just. My main thing was not to get in the way. And the first script that I really took over was in 4. And I thought I was clever by not reading the script apart from the stuff that I had to say or do, so I didn't manipulate the audience. And I guess it worked because I was doing it as innocently as the audience was watching me. So at the end of the movie, I don't know who's seen number 4, but when I get off the chair, does anybody remember that? Everybody was surprised. And, you know, I was kind of proud that I surprised the audience. But in between all of these movies, I had a lot of laughs, to be honest with you. People were suffering, they were in traps, you know, sometimes 6 and 8 hours a day, they'd be like, you know, mangled positions and stuff like that. And I'd go up and tickle them and make them laugh, and they hated me for it. I remember Donnie Wahlberg was, if anybody hasn't seen this, it was a scene where he had to be on an ice block, a real ice block, and he was chained up at the hip and by, you know, like it looked uncomfortable, and it was. And I was next to him on this chair looking like a victim myself. And he had a fake beard on because time had passed and they had to glue it on in the mornings and it's a pain in the ass, your itchy face and all that stuff. And I remember that I'd have to be gagged up for most of the scene, well, for the scene. And every now and then they'd take off my gag and I was like making phone calls and making bets to my bookie. I was driving him crazy because I had to shut up for like hours on end, right? But I would make, what's his name, Donnie Wahlberg laugh so much and it was hot and he was sweating, his beard started to fall off and he was cursed, shut the fuck up, don't say anything. I kept making, and they had to go up and take him off and climb, then they got a ladder to do this thing on him and I made him crazy. So the best thing was busting everybody's chops in between all this gory stuff that you see. But he hated me and loved me at the same time because I was funny, but that beard was really uncomfortable and it would take time to put, glue it back on. But I managed to have a lot of fun.
Humor is your best friend.
You know, I gotta tell you, making movies sometimes can be, well, if you wanna be good, it's hard work, but at times you have a lot of laughs as well with certain people, you know what I mean?
You bet.
Yeah.
You do.
Great memories. I mean, you guys, you ever seen bloopers from movies? Or yeah, bloopers on comedy shows, that's a gift to us, to burst out laughing, you know, when you can't get something right, but eventually you'll get it right and go home proud. But in between, we have some good times.
Is the detective killer here today?
Say again?
The detective killer in the Saw movies.
What's the question?
Is he here today?
The killer, the original? Yeah. I'm the protege to Tobin Bell, who was Jigsaw.
Okay.
So I'm the baby that took over.
Okay. Which saw was it that you came in
on? I was introduced to 3, but 4 is when I was revealed at the end of the. I wish some people knew that, but it was fun because the audience that was so huge went, "Holy fucking shit, it's him!" And you know that's kind of cool to hear.
So when you went in on the third one, Were you aware from the first and second, like, this is a big franchise, or was it still kind of like, oh, it's just part of a series, or?
Well, I went there in good faith,
yeah.
And I actually, I'll tell you how it happened. I was invited to an office, and the producers wanted me to meet the director, and he asked me if I'd seen the Saw movies, the first 2 that were hugely popular, and I said no. And the director ended up leaving the room, and the producer looked at me. He said, "What the fuck's wrong with you? Why didn't you tell me you saw the movies?" I said, I didn't want to lie. He said, "You live in Hollywood. That's what we do." But I was really embarrassed about it too. I said I should have been smarter. But in the end, I did the third one, and I got along well with the crew, who worked long, long hours. Thank God for the crew, our brothers, right behind the scenes. But a few people were misbehaving, and in the good thing for the producers and the bad for the actors that were misbehaving, they can kill you real easy. But I got on really well with everybody, and they brought me on, and I ended up finishing the franchise to the end. So I got lucky. Not lucky, I was respectful to people and I did my job. And respect is a good thing, because when it's not happening, it's not fun. And you can get killed real easy in a horror movie, and then bring somebody else to replace you.
Yeah, most the greatest fun is be playing liar's poker with the crew. That's what I do. I go out back and play liar's poker with the crew. I'd bum cigarettes off of them. I love crew.
Oh yeah.
And one thing I can't deal with is when a director goes off on the crew because they're behind and he blames the crew. That really pisses me off. And usually, that's going to do nothing but slow the crew down, and good for them, you know?
Yeah.
Is Rob Zombie a fun director to work with?
He's a sweet man, but
good. Absolutely, absolutely great. He's super smart, you know, his persona is so different than what people think. Mm-hmm. To me, he's more like a college professor than he is, you know, some whatever other people may think about him. He's a lot of fun to work with. He puts a lot of trust in his people. He certainly did with me, and you know, I would go to him and I would tell him, "Look, I think we should do this," and without even hesitation, he would go, "Absolutely." And he would put a lot of trust in me, and so what you end up with on film is really amazing with Rob, because you never really know what's going to happen next.
And he, you know,
well, you know, I mean, the real character I played was the one in the scene with Steven. That's who this guy really was.
Jesus Christ, fucking mess.
You Ford dump truck has a tendency of doing that, Kenny. Listen, you mind getting one of your donut brigades going over there and scoop up some of that skull matter, put it in the bag for the meds? Yeah, you got it. Is that the lady who found her?
Yeah, the maid. That's Maria Govans.
She say anything?
Yeah, a lot of things. But I don't speak no Spanish. It's all mumbo jumbo to me. Shit, what am I, Mayo Tijuana or something? Got one guy. Clark's, he speaks Spanish, but he called in sick. What he calls explosive diarrhea.
You mind sparing me any further details about your deputy's asshole, Kenny?
But, you know, like any other person, you know, come along, kill their brother, you know, kill all these people, do something, and, you know, another person emerges from inside. And it's a complex film because of that. I mean, you start out being John Wayne, and then, you know, and the next thing you know, you're, you know, the cowboy hat comes off and you're this guy who's worse than them, you know. And so it's, you know, but he's fun to work with. He really is. I enjoy Rob. I love Sherry, and, you know, anytime.
Scene with the mother in the jail cell's
pretty. That old whore. That's good. Yeah. Well, Leslie was something. That character, she, oh my God.
She was crazy.
Yeah, I just turned around and went, "What?" She's beautiful, you know. But that whole group is amazing to work with. They're like a family, and whether you showed up for a day or whatever, you know, you're a member of the team, and we had a lot of fun, you know. And Jim, man, what am I in the mirror, fucking Tijuana?
Yeah, what am I, fucking Tijuana?
I don't know. Me no spreckity. He's hysterical.
Yeah, you played the cop with her.
Yeah.
Cleaning up the girl that
ran
away.
Yeah. But I love that scene because it's the only scene where you see what Wydell would be like under normal circumstance. Because the two of us talk to each other like two old buddies. And it's the only time in the whole movie you see that, because he's on a mission the rest of the movie. You know, so you see this little window in what life would be like, other than, you know, chasing the friggin' fireflies around, you know.
Do any of you guys find dialect to be really tough? I know, because, you know, Costas, you were the Italian guy at the door, the count, right? Yeah. And then you were the butcher. I mean, when you did the butcher, you all have different accents. Do you find the accents tougher to do than the physicality of the role sometimes? I mean, is it more difficult to get an accent and get it right than just be with all the physical activity? You know what I'm saying? To prepare for physical activity, is the dialogue tougher to prepare for?
Man, if you're a professional and you're gonna do something right,
right,
you gotta dedicate. There's no room for error if you care.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Is it tougher to do the dialect more than even getting physically ready for
it? It has to become part of what you're doing in order for it to really work. It's not just learning a dialect. You hear people all the time in movies doing a dialect, and you just, oh god.
Yeah.
Because it's just, it has to be so much more than a dialect. It has to become part of what you're doing. You know, it's like before somebody, we were talking about learning lines, you asked the question, and Steve kind of touched upon it, but you don't ever really learn them. And it's when it all makes sense. It's once you do all the work and all the, everything you're doing begins to make sense, the lines just instantly appear. And with the dialect, it's very important to make that become an organic thing and part of what you're doing. You have to almost live it. You have to, it's more than just, you know, people. You could tell people right away in movies who learn a dialect, because it's like, oh, here we go. Yeah.
Can you guys talk about how you first got into acting? Was it like through theater, or like when you were kids, or how you first got introduced?
Let's start this direction.
How it began?
Yeah, how you began your acting.
Personally, I came to America to visit a friend, and all of a sudden, these people are going, you should be an actor, you should be, what are you talking about? This is 89, right? And I'm going, what do you mean? And all of a sudden I said, well, what are they telling me this for? I went to an acting class and I sat there with people like this, and I went, I'm sitting in class with people like this, I'm going, what am I doing here? And I found, I hated school, but I found acting class so interesting that I'd go to double classes during the week, 4 hours a piece. I'd skip school, man. I ran away from school, but classes were interesting because it wasn't just acting class, because some people in acting class are terrible, but it was the behavior of people, and it became interesting. To be a great actor or a very good actor takes a lot of shit, you know what I mean? And I was intrigued of how you become good. To become good takes a lot of time, a lot of work. Some people instinctively good, some people become better, but that was interesting. And I just ended up, I got a movie with Willem Dafoe, Robert Loggia, and Eddie Olmos. It was my first real movie after a shitty movie that I did to make $4,000 to pay the acting coach who had faith in me. But when I worked with these guys, it was like, it's like you go to another planet. Then you go to Auschwitz and shoot your first movie. It is another planet. And it's never ending interesting. You know what I mean? That's why these stories are fantastic. It's sort of re-inspiring. It's not over yet. We can become better and we can try something different. And that's what kept me going. It's an interesting gig.
It's the truth. You know what you just said? Once you know it all, that's the beginning of the fall. And that goes about life too. You learn something every fucking day. And you never know it all until death gets in the way, and you don't even know it all then, and you move on. But it's got to be a passion, and I think that's what you were talking about. When I flew from a small town in Texas to New York, and it was 7 days a week. I mean, it wasn't just when class was, it was every day, sensory work. You like to say, you can do that walking down the street, and it's 7 days a week, and it's a passion. And you keep, you know, in New York, I did so many plays, so many. And I was probably paid for seven of them. But I did 30 some odd plays. But I worked on Broadway, I worked off Broadway, I worked off Broadway, off Broadway, off Broadway, off Broadway. And I did a play in the streets of Bedford-Stuyvesant. You know, and I just loved it. And you eat it, you sleep it, you live it. I mean, it's like anything we do in life, whether it's what my passion is, what our passion is. We all have a passion. Just live it and keep doing it and keep taking chances. What's the point of living if you play safe? Dive off cliffs, take fucking chances, do it. I mean, take a risk. All the time, take risks. Who gives a damn? Just go for it.
That's now that kind of passion. That kind of passion is, you know, I worry sometimes. I look around. Thank God it's not completely gone. But you know, I mean, I've worked with, you know, younger actors or someone, and someone looks at me and they looking right through me, and I'm like, and I'm trying to explain that, you know, surround yourself with you know, like-minded people, surround yourself with people who are passionate about the work, and really, you know, live small, and just trying to talk about all the things that it takes to begin the process. And I get some guy there, and I can tell he's just annoyed listening to me, and suddenly it's like, yeah, you know, I'm cool with all this stuff, but, you know, the reason I'm here is I wanted to know if you could hook me up.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm just like, the only person who's gonna hook you up is McDonald's up the street, buddy. I said, you know, even begin to understand what this work is about. I said, you know, you need to go and do homework until the end of time and then come back to, you know, to try to begin to understand what this process is. In my case, I was a juvenile delinquent, okay? I was in school, and this teacher caught me on something and was about to, you know, tell my father, which was a death sentence. And he basically blackmailed me into doing a play. And that's how I began my process. But I got very serious about it. Also, I left home at 17 and I lived like Steve was talking about. I mean, I lived on people's couches. I slept in theaters. Mm-hmm. I did things that you couldn't even believe me. And there was a time I actually was camped out where Errol Flynn used to live out in LA. Mm-hmm. I had a pup tent on an old tennis court, and I had all the fences rigged with cans so that if any of the junkies came in the middle of the night, you know, I would hear them. You know, and this was, you know, because I had nothing. You know, all my money went to acting class. All my money went to try to be good, because it was important to us to be good and to try
and
our
to
best.
Keep growing, you know. Growing.
What do you think is the best way to get into acting?
The hard way. I mean, you know, you have to be, you know, there's no easy way. I mean, a lot of people now, they were more concerned. Look, they just did a survey with all these kids, and it was like, you know, what do you want to be when you grow up? 90-something% of them said rich.
Yeah.
You know? No, it wasn't, I want to be a doctor, I want to be this, I want to be, it was the result of the race. You need to dig in, you need to work very hard at anything. But, you know, right now, the result of the race seems to be more important. So I always, like, I try to inspire people, any person I can. If you want to do what we do, you have to not do it for success, for money, for anything. You have to do it to do it right, you know, to do it correctly, to get out and work your ass off, you know. It's not a profession to recommend. You know, my daughter decided she was going to be an actress, and I looked and I said, are you sure? I said, this is not, you know, and, you know, it may seem like it's an easy life, but if you don't love it, it's going to beat you to death, you know, so, but we love it.
Yeah, that's a hard question. How do you get into it? People have asked me some questions, and I'm like, I can't answer that for you. You're going to find out when you do something about it. You know what I mean? Somebody wanting a hookup. I know a million actors. I know guys that are successful. I've never asked them for shit. You're going to find what you find if you grab it.
You better have a passion for it.
Yeah.
As many auditions as you can.
It's hard work to do it right, and if you don't think so, I mean, I meet people all the time that they just, they look,
the way to end yourself, I mean, I'm sure the battlefields of the world are full of people who overestimated their ability and underestimated their opponent. That's basically what you can't do. You have to like be the most humble person trying to climb Mount Everest every day in order to get it right.
That's why the Kardashians get on my nerves. I don't care about their money, man. But they're on every magazine. Like, we give a damn about what. You better not be reading those magazines, yeah. Young ladies. I had to say that. I'd rather see doctors and actors, somebody doing something on those magazine covers. Yes, sir.
Do you guys agree with what he said about being humble? In order to get it right.
One of the greatest qualities of human is humility, humble. Yeah, man. I mean, you got to be proud. You got to stand up. I mean, he's fearsome.
Being humble, he's right. You do, because you have to be open to everything. But at the same time, you don't get stepped on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but we should all have a passion. And if you, whatever we do in life, God damn it, go for it. Just, God, I can't think of, I stepped off an airplane in New York, my small town in Texas, September the 28th, 1967. I was 7 years old. I'm a lion sack, but no, I did. And I went to New York to study. I didn't think about anything. I just wanted to learn. And fate, I'll tell you real quick what fate is. I stayed at a place called the Hotel Lucerne, and it was raining September the 28th, 1967, when I got off that plane. And I went, took a cab into New York, Kennedy Airport, and I stayed at a place called the Hotel Lucerne, and I got up the next morning, and I went to a phone booth. They used to have phone booths back then, and I went to a phone booth, and I looked in the yellow pages under D for drama, T for theater, I can't remember, but I found this school, and it was on the 8th floor of Carnegie Hall, and I'm in there for about 3 or 4 weeks, and I realized there's something wrong. Even though I'd never been in class, I knew it was general, and I knew it was not right. But it just so happened that on the 10th floor of Carnegie Hall, Lee Strasberg had his private classes. Now that's his fate, because why would I pick a class at Carnegie Hall on the 8th floor and not knowing that Lee was up there? So I'd go up to Lee's classes, and I would listen outside the door just to hear him speak. I just listen. And one day, Walter Lott, who was the secretary of the class and a member of the Actors Studio, came up to me and he said, I see you out here and you're so excited, but you really shouldn't be doing this. And so he told me what you do to get into this class, and you have to take a picture of yourself and then write a letter to Lee and tell him why you want to study with him. Now, I don't know what I said in that letter, but I know it came from my heart, and I got a call from his secretary, and I went to his place in the Upper West Side, and he let me into the class. But also, I joined because of Walter Lott. He had a theater. Everything kind of moves into place. And he had a place called the Unit Theater, and it was a workshop, and we did plays. But fate. Fate is a big word to me, and responsibility is another one. But fate is a big word. And then okay.
You know what? I don't know about you guys, but one of my favorite words is sincerity. I sincerely enjoyed this time.
Yeah, I did too.
I really did. I mean, I learned some stuff here from me. And you guys are great listeners. A bit rowdy.
Yeah, that's awesome.
I think we have time for one more question, if anybody has one.
Is there going to be a Saw
8? I hope so, for the people that love that stuff. And I hope I live through it and see you guys again. But they're saying they're preparing a script, but they're kind of cryptic about it. But I think they're working on something. They took 2 years off. There is an audience and a younger audience that's probably, you know, interested. I mean, when they first came out, you were probably a baby, you know. They're like 10 years old, 12 years old now from the beginning. So the possibility is there, I think.
Well, God bless you all.
Thank you. Love it.
All right, my friends.
Sure.